This is the story of the greatest hotel this area has ever seen. Indeed, it's the story of Scranton, for the hotel mirrors its rise and fall. Despite prohibition, a depression, two world wars, and a four-alarm fire, our hero stood. A dance with neglect secured its downfall. Is the sacrifice of an icon justified, or should a community rally to save the colossal figures of its past from the same fate as the Hotel Casey? With a silver-plated pick and shovel and a golden spirit of optimism, A.J. and P.J. Casey broke ground on the corner of Lackawanna and Adams Avenue, a site that would turn from dirt and gravel to the epitome of luxury and comfort, the Hotel Casey. Born of humble origins in County Sligo, Ireland, the Casey brothers filtered into Scranton in the late 1800s. First Andrew Joseph at age 14 in 1872, and then Patrick Joseph at age 15 in 1883. They joined the family's liquor business, where they began their fortune. The brothers embodied the American ideals of rugged individualism, a strong work ethic, and shrewd business sense, earning a reputation as progressive and energetic businessmen. Newspapers lauded the siblings as self-made in every sense of the word, and, as always, investing their profits back into Scranton. In 1900, when two of the city's prominent theaters, the Academy and the Lyceum, were about to close, A.J. and P.J. Casey rescued them. They even financed the area's first semi-professional baseball team. In Ireland, a leprechaun leads some lucky person to gold. A.J. and P.J. Casey, believing that Scranton was destined to become a metropolis, were leprechauns to this town, and the luck of the Irish brought Scranton an 11-story pot of gold.
They had a lot of vision for this area, and at that time it was a very affluent, prosperous area, and there wasn't any real grand hotel to accommodate these many people that came through all the time, and they just had visited all over the world and country and felt that there was a great need for something like this in this area.
The end of the rainbow landed on Casey Corner. The downtown site was only a block away from Scranton's gateway, the Delaware, Lackawanna, and Western Railroad station, from which the Casey would receive 95% of its business until the age of the auto. Fittingly, it was also the original estate of George W. Scranton, whose blast furnaces helped build this city. Now the site was to be the home of the next generation of Scranton pioneers, the Casey brothers, and their red brick giant. The demand for a grand hotel came from traveling businessmen who complained about an inadequacy of decent lodgings. Overflow from Scranton's insufficient hotels was rechanneled to rooms as far north as Carbondale or as far south as Wilkes-Barre.
Before 1895, I mean, Scranton was a relatively new city, and the hotels that you had in the city were a series of pretty small places. You know, not that some of them weren't nice places to stay, but there was no one grand central place. And then in 1895, they built the Hotel German, which was a very nice hotel and one that I think is sort of underestimated in the history of the city now. But when the Casey was built, we really had a great modern building that was comparable to hotels in cities larger than Scranton across the country.
And so in 1905, one Casey said to another, "Why not build it ourselves?" The brothers hired the noted architect Charles Weatherhog for their grand project, but many scoffed at the Casey's plan, saying it was too elaborate for a city this size and would flop. Weatherhog had designed a hotel more than quadruple the size of most inns. But the idealism of the brothers was unquenchable, and the million-dollar plans for the perfect hotel proceeded. The vision of the Caseys capitalized on coal, the trains, and the rapidly growing city. By 1910, five railroads and 500 factories filled the electric city. By 1912, enough black gold was mined from beneath Scranton to fill the Panama Canal, making it the third largest city in Pennsylvania, 37th in the nation, and the greatest mining city in the world.
Scranton was the pivot city of the coal industry. Not only of the coal industry, but every industry that went along with the coal business. Could have been electricity, parts for electric pumps, motors, helmets, lights, you name it. Usually they had an office in Scranton, Pennsylvania. You know, at the time of the heyday of the Casey, most people depended upon mass transportation. Here we are in the electric city in Scranton, Pennsylvania, where the first electric streetcar was successfully operated.
The Mammoth Hotel was built almost entirely by local companies. Frank Carlucci of Carlucci Stone Company, who built the Luzerne County Courthouse, was hired as the contractor. And on March 28, 1910, the company laid the cornerstone. Weatherhog proposed the name the Casey Grand Hotel, feeling the Grand added a continental touch. But the Irish brothers opted for a simpler name, the Hotel Casey. After 2 years, the million-dollar addition to Scranton Skyline opened, and northeastern Pennsylvanians came in 10,000 strong. A modern 250-room, 11-story hotel towered above Scranton. Newspapers called it magnificent, declaring it would stand forever. The Tribune Republican wrote that men in evening clothes, women in décolleté, lawyers, doctors, architects, bankers, merchants, bookkeepers, clerks, laboring men and their wives, women from the stores and offices of the city, school teachers, society leaders, and club women were guests at the opening, and their criticism of the building embodied one word: perfect.
I don't think there's no other word that would fit the occasion. In its day, I think it was beyond. It's time.
The Casey imposed itself majestically on the horizon with Indiana limestone and pressed red brick. Scrolls, acanthuses, lion's head motifs, and the hotel's initials garnished the upper levels. A copper cornice crowned the structure, while an electric sign added later became the crown's gemstone, glittering throughout the night. Visitors were greeted by an expansive lobby bathed in beautiful marble and floor-to-ceiling columns in the neo-Renaissance style. The first floor housed the Tudor-style baronial palm court, the men's only gentleman's cafe and grill, and the Italian cafe Sinfonelli. The most striking room was the gold room. The Scranton Times referred to its elaborate ceilings and 15 chandeliers as a dream of beauty in the French Renaissance.
Big, beautiful, new. They had the best of everything over there. Brass railings, marble stairways, chandeliers like you never saw before.
The brass railing of the grand staircase, or the escort of an elevator girl, would bring you to the mezzanine, which wrapped the atrium. Looking upward revealed an octagonal glass skylight, washing the lobby in soft green light.
I always remember the mezzanine when you could look up and see that magnificent dome, the colors in it. We used to think it was maybe the closest you'd ever get to heaven.
The mezzanine included a ladies' parlor with an $1,800 Steinway grand piano, a writing room, several suites, and the great banquet room, later known as the Crystal Ballroom.
Well, the Crystal Ballroom was something like you wouldn't see here in Scranton today. Very ornate, a lot of gold leaf, beautiful chandeliers.
They had magnificent, magnificent crystal chandeliers. I don't know how many there were.
Five chandeliers hovered amidst the lofty interior, which could seat 500 people. On the far wall were these words in old English letters: "Begone, dull care, I prithee, begone from me."
Just everything in it was of the finest, you know, the marble, the bronze, the brass, and solid bronze elevators. There was bevel glass in all the break fronts and all throughout every part of the hotel. The cathedral ceilings, the mezzanine. It was just, it was a conversation piece. It was spectacular. It was comparable to the plaza in places like the Bellevue Stratford and Philadelphia and everything. There was just nothing like it in really in northeastern Pennsylvania, there was nothing like it.
No expense was spared for furnishings. Marble, mahogany, and stained glass all coated the Casey. Walking through it was like walking on cushions. Rooms were carpeted with Wilt and velvet, corridors with Royal Axminster. No three of the 250 rooms were wallpapered alike, and every room had a telephone. Store and Pfister and Jennings of Washington Avenue furnished the hotel for $70,000.
My grandfather and Uncle AJ wanted it to be absolutely perfect, and that's what it really was.
The Casey coat of arms, a shield with a chevron, three figureheads, and the motto, Per Various Casus, or Through Many Vicissitudes, decorated the hotel's furnishings.
Each bedspread had the coat of arms on it. Every room had a wastebasket with the coat of arms, the phone book with the coat of arms, all the silverware, the dinner plates, everything.
Nothing had been overlooked. Fresh flowers were delivered every morning. The chandeliers were rubbed ceremoniously each day. Even the heating and ventilating systems were arranged so the rooms were always at even temperatures. Every conceivable convenience had been included.
You wouldn't believe it. We had so many conveniences. Tail shop, bake shop.
Two banks. They had a barber shop. They had their own grocery store. They had a steward.
Laundry.
We had a pharmacy.
Generated their own electricity from the bottom floor to the mezzanine.
The newsstand, a cigar stand.
All right there in that one building.
It was a world in itself. I mean, it was a little city. It had everything there that you could want.
You didn't have to go out to build it for nothing.
To run the 11-story city, 20 tons of coal were burned daily, and an army of 200 employees satisfied guests' needs, wants, and whims. One of the most noted was a bellhop named Pee-wee.
So I was weighing about 118 pounds, 20 soaking wet maybe. So he just gave me the name Pee-wee. And when I went to the Casey, nobody knew what my name was except up in the office. They knew it was Marshall Martin up in the office, but everybody else, it was Pee-wee. Even Tish.
But he was an institution of the hotel, you know, he really was.
Do you remember his real name?
She didn't find out my name until 2 years ago.
So we only knew him as Pee-wee. Marshall.
Correct, correct.
White-gloved waiters adorned the elegant public spaces, serving the food that made Casey Corner famous.
Well, I've been a lot of places in my 70-odd years, and I don't think I ever tasted food like that.
In a place where you were always going to get, you know, a great meal with impeccable service. It was just a spit-and-polish place.
The creations of the Casey chefs were renowned, and the one meal you had to have was the chicken a la king.
One thing that people came from all over, and it sounds like a Chamber of Commerce luncheon, but it isn't, was their chicken a la king. It was made with heavy cream, sherry, and shoestring potatoes. Everybody get dressed to the nines on Saturday and go to the cocktail lounge for lunch. That was something you had to have. Everything was flown in fresh every day. The fish, their beef, and anything that was there like one day was thrown out or given to the poor. My father was a great one for sending things to the soup kitchen.
The hotel attained national recognition by following the Casey Golden Rule, doing a little more for the other fellow than you would have him do for you.
Service, excellent. We knew it. We knew we were good. You could hear about the service in the Hotel Casey all over the state. We knew just about when every flight was doing after we got plane service. We knew when the trains were in. We knew when almost each customer was going to come in.
And the service was beyond reproach. Everybody said that ever entered the place.
You didn't see nobody quitting. Why do you think I stayed 26 years? 26 years, I stayed and went to stay 6 weeks. It was peaceful.
Not only was it peaceful, but it was also profitable.
If you didn't make $30 a day, $40 a day, except you had a bad day.
A reporter encapsulated the Casey with this quote. Every detail is in harmony, making the establishment a restful, home-like place for the traveling public and a source of pride for the citizens of Scranton. It was an acme of perfection that would grow with Scranton. And grow it did. In just 2 years, plans for 100 more rooms were on the drawing board. The architect, Weatherhog, had provided for this addition by designing the building in an inverted L shape above the second floor. And in 1916, the L was made into a U. This resulted in 350 rooms and the third largest banquet facilities in Pennsylvania. Business continued to roar throughout the 20s. To accommodate the auto, a $350,000 parking garage was built with 500 spaces. Medallions depicting various modes of transportation decorated the facade. Ironically, guests rarely saw this work of art as the hotel provided valet service. A lack of competition spurred the Casey's wild success.
We couldn't miss. I mean, how could we miss? We had no competition. Who do we have?
And we had this German hotel across town here, but it was, could never hold a candle to the Casey in the old days.
We called the German a rooming house. We didn't consider that as no competition to us.
Even though Prohibition turned the bar into a pharmacy, the hotel was no more dry than the rest of the Electric City. John Beck writes in his History of Scranton that throughout the 20s, hordes of ne'er-do-wells descended on the Casey for hooch, gambling, and pleasures of the flesh.
This is an interesting souvenir from the Prohibition era. And although it was rather difficult at that time to acquire alcohol, the Hotel Casey had a bit of a reputation as being one of the more wet areas. This is 1926. Actually, a friend of mine acquired this off of the internet. Came from the Hotel Casey drug shop. Prescription here for champagne. I suppose they saw no other way to brush the dark clouds away than a little of the old bubbly.
Prohibition was kicked in 1933 and the bar was reopened, legally at least, and now both men and women could be found there. While Republicans flocked to the Hotel German, Democrats descended upon the Casey bar. Senators, mayors, and governors were said to have been made and toppled in informal caucuses held at what was nicknamed the Democratic Party headquarters. Scranton's boom continued as it kept harvesting its underground fields of anthracite. AJ and PJ even considered constructing a new $2 million hotel with Turkish baths, a roof garden, and 500 rooms, but the plans never materialized. By the 1930s, the automobile had begun its assault on passenger trains. Also, the hotel suffered two great losses. Andrew Joseph, at age 72 in 1928, and Patrick Joseph, at age 66 in 1934.
So that's when my father was at Harvard Law School and had to come home and take over everything.
PJ's eldest son, J.G. Casey, now led the management, whom honored their predecessors by cherishing the traditions of high quality and service. In 1936, just 2 years after PJ's death, a silver anniversary dinner was held in the Casey to commemorate its 25 years as a family institution and a hero to Scranton.
You know, where my money? You know, everybody had it. And the hotel was full. I mean, we were booked to capacity most days.
In 1947, old age spurred a million-dollar makeover, complete with a new wardrobe. New furniture, carpeting, and modern entrance marquees were installed, along with TV and air conditioning. Unfortunately, no more soft green light would fill the lobby. The skylight was closed up to expand banquet facilities on the above floor. However, no amount of renovation could stem the rising popularity of the Motor Inn. But the Casey was still a social hub. No other building was a friend to Scrantonians like the Casey. On the hotel's 50th anniversary, the Scranton Times wrote that probably every man and woman in the region had, at one time or another, attended a dance, ate a meal, or sipped a drink at the Hotel Casey.
The Hotel Casey, at the height of its popularity and its serving of the community, it was probably considered or compared to be the plaza of Scranton. There was no other hotel in northeastern Pennsylvania that could compare to the Hotel Casey.
One of the hotel's most famous events was in March of 1964 at the Friendly Sons of St. Patrick's annual dinner. The principal speaker, Robert F. Kennedy. It was his first public appearance after the assassination of his brother.
The Attorney General of the United States, the Honorable Robert F. Kennedy.
As the first of the racial minorities, our forefathers were subject to every kind of discrimination. But the Irish progressed. 40 years ago, my father left the city of Boston because of the sign that said, "No Irish need apply." And yet he had two sons who were senators from the state of Massachusetts and one son who was president of the United States. So we have problems.
A journalist wrote that the crowd was so large and exuberant that the hotel's heavy doors were torn from their hinges as people pressed forward to shake his hand.
Young man who was close to my brother Dave Powers, whose whole family came from Ireland. And when the Shah of Iran came to visit, he said, "He's our kind of Shah." And when he moved into the White House, he said, "This is our kind of White House." And when I told him I was coming up here, he said, "They're our kind of Irish."
RFK was just one of the many who signed the Casey's guest book, a who's who of celebrities.
I met people that I would have never seen. That I read about. Jack Palance, Jesse Owens, John L. Lewis, Orson Welles.
Eleanor Roosevelt, Vice President Richard Nixon.
Presidents.
John Kennedy came.
Truman.
And Hubert Humphrey said every time he came to Scranton, Preno's had a fire.
They don't care about stuff. The bands, the big bands, the ones that have stuff.
Daddy surprised me and had Jimmy and Tommy Dorsey play at my birthday party.
Ron Monroe. Alan Les Brown.
Glenn Gray, Fred Waring, Skitch Henderson, singers Nat King Cole, Tony Martin, Rudy Valli, Paul Robeson, Enrico Caruso, Louis Prima, and Keeley Smith.
At Von Monroe, we got where we were, like, grew up together.
The Casey used to be the main stop for the vaudeville days. Arthur Godfrey, Joey Bishop, Three Stooges.
Joe Pennert, Jerry Lewis, Dean Martin, Bob Hope.
Abbott and Costello, Amos and Andy, Jack Benny and Rochester.
Champions, baseball players.
Babe Ruth, Joe DiMaggio, Lou Gehrig, Satchel Paige, Cy Young.
Yeah, by the way, I saw Ted Williams there, too.
Movie stars Burns and Allen, Ronald Reagan, Barbara Stanwyck, Irene Dunne.
Jimmy Braddock, the world champion.
Sonny Liston, Jack Dempsey, Rocky Marciano. Sugar Ray Robinson.
I couldn't remember all of them if I tried, but it was a pleasure. And most of them, after they knew me for a while, didn't call me Marshall either. They sent Pee Wee up.
You were able to think, you know, well, people are going to be traveling through Scranton, you know, they're going to see our city, they're going to stay in this great hotel, and this is what's going to leave an impression on them. That's what they're going to remember of Scranton, and I think it gave people a lot of good things to remember when they left.
In 1961, the management of the Casey became guests in their own place, and all of Scranton turned out for the Golden Jubilee. The perfect hotel had garnered local and national recognition for its first-class food, service, and beauty. The Casey seemed ready for another 50 years. It came as a shock to everyone when the Casey family sold the hotel in 1962.
Everything was rosy until about the late 50s. There wasn't no more of those $40 nights and $100 nights and nothing like that. If you made 15 bucks, you were lucky.
In 1956, the hotel had suffered another terrible loss, J.G. Casey. He had served as president since 1934, the year his father, P.J., passed on.
I think it really, when my father died, that was kind of it. Because he was the brains of the whole place.
Everybody was getting old, and everybody wanted that cut. And business had gone kaput.
Nationally, oil was replacing coal as a cheap fuel. Locally, the 1959 Knox mine disaster flooded the valley's underground, signaling the end of King Coal's reign. The decrease in anthracite production went hand in hand with the decline of Casey Corner and Scranton. Also, urban planners were inducing a mass exodus from cities, making downtowns into ghost towns.
People were moving from the city to the outskirts of the city, into what we call suburbia. This is probably one of the causes of a grand hotel like the Casey not surviving in today's marketplace.
The Golden Age had become the Formica Age. World War II spawned a nation of convenience-oriented conservatives who cared about functionality without the opulence. Up went the cookie-cutter houses, malls, and motels on the edges of the cities.
As northeastern Pennsylvania opened up with the great highway system that we see today, you did see the mom-and-pops open up on the side of the roads, people being more transient in their cars. It's easier to pull in front of a motel.
Motels cater to the auto age with less overhead costs and modest room rates, capitalizing on the country that now traveled on highways, not rails.
And also, you know, in the late 50s and 60s, we lost people coming into Scranton via the train.
The highways began to pass by. Then we got plane service. My son graduated in 61. He came in at prom night. Said, Dad, something happened at this hotel. I said, yeah, Bob, it's sort of going down.
In room 316, the Casey family sold its 51-year-old heirloom. And so started the dance on Casey Corner, where many would court the grand dame, but all were turned away. The first partner was a 46-year-old bachelor named Lloyd Rackmill, who bought the hotel for $800,000.
he was a good man, but he didn't know nothing. He just didn't have no system. If you wanted rye toast, many mornings he had to send out to get the rye toast. He didn't have no bread. Yeah, that's the truth. I'm not lying. Sometimes no milk. Got sent down to the corner store to get milk.
How come he didn't have any milk or bread in the...
They wouldn't buy it. They wouldn't buy it, that's why.
Rackmill, failing to turn a profit, transferred operation of the hotel in 1968 to Albert D. Soma and ADS Incorporated. When the Scranton Tribune asked Soma what he intended to do with the hotel, he replied, run it right. But the dance was too expensive.
We would go there, but it wasn't the same, you know what I mean? And we just didn't go there anymore.
The end came on July 17, 1969, when the Philadelphia Life Insurance Company foreclosed on the mortgage. New locks had to be fitted, since the keys were thrown away when the doors first opened in 1911.
The Hotel Casey wasn't the only business like that that closed in the late 1960s. In cities like Scranton, across the country, places like this closed.
In September of 1969, ownership went to Philadelphia Life, who bought the real estate to protect their investment. A month earlier, they bought the Casey's contents at a sheriff's sale for $55,000, a fraction of its real value.
Every private dining room had a piano. They had a beautiful baby grand in the gold room, uprights in all the rooms. I don't know whatever happened to all those things, you know. It's just very disheartening.
Then in November of 1969, to everyone's amazement, the hotel opened again. Three local suitors from Dunmore, Albert Frangell, Dr. Joseph Petrillo, and Samuel Scrimali, founded the Aljosam Corporation and entered into a five-year lease purchase agreement for $500,000. It was rumored that their long-range plan was to convert the hotel into a nursing home. They spent $1 million in improvements, including a new sign for a new name. Another change was opening the My King Chinese restaurant in the mid-1970s, in the room described as a dream of beauty in the French Renaissance, the Gold Room.
The people just weren't coming to town like they used to. And then when the Chinese restaurant went out, it seemed that was the downfall of the case. And it just kept going down ever since.
I really think he did the best he could. They had no knowledge of hotel operation. First of all, you have to be polite. Good morning, sir. Speak to people. Don't arm your whole head up in the and I'm spending my hard-earned money in your bar. People notice that. Not that they were that bad, you know, they just didn't have the touch like.
There just wasn't enough business to fill the ailing hotel. The Casey was diagnosed with financial paralysis, and Al Josan had no luck in finding a cure.
Part of its success and everything was that people knew that it was a family-owned hotel, and the family itself was famous. I think that's where a lot of loyalty came. And then after these almost charlatans came in and took over, a lot of the people that went there all the time didn't like doing business with them because of some of their tactics.
In January of 1970, fire broke out. The Scranton Times reported that the landmark was remarkably fire resistant, but it still suffered damage, $2 million worth.
That was a disaster. I remember I saw it on television, I got hysterical.
9 years later, three fires broke out on the fourth and eighth floors. In 1980, the cost of utilities and taxes forced the management to ask 100 permanent guests to leave. The next year, the top seven floors were closed because of heating problems. The end came on July 7, 1982. In 1982, the city included the structure in a sale of delinquent properties. The Casey owed more than $500,000 in taxes. The Petrillo's attorney promised the taxes would be paid if the building was removed from the sale. The promise was only a delay tactic that inflicted the largest insult ever on the building. Like rooting through the home of someone who had passed on, the Casey was gutted in a desperate attempt to pay the back taxes.
It's just heartbreaking because people were allowed to go in and ravaged the place, actually.
Out came the chandeliers, marble bathroom fixtures, furniture, cooking equipment, and brass. Walls were torn open for the copper pipes and windows smashed to move the valuables out, causing an obscene amount of damage.
They owed us so much money on the second mortgage. They owed $381,000 in taxes and were allowed to go in and strip the place and sell everything, and I don't know how they got away with it.
After the grave digging, the building was left to rot. Its only guests were now those uninvited, vandals, pigeons, and water. On New Year's Eve in 1983, the very industry which was the reason for the Casey's existence and which sat vacant in the 1970s received a $13 million renovation. The Lackawanna Railroad Station was turned into a luxury hotel. The Casey was officially dethroned. Scores of developers were interested in refurbishing the tarnished throne. The University of Scranton even considered it for a giant dormitory. But continuous deterioration due to water leakage and inadequate financing packages worked against developers. Each year, the cost of restoration rose by millions. It nearly happened in the late 1980s.
And all that money that was supposed to be done for the restoration at that point was given to the man at the Globe store, and he went bankrupt and left town. And so that fell through the cracks.
The city gained control of the building in 1989 on a tax claim, and still nothing happened. The only proposal to ever materialize was to board the building up in 1992, 10 years after it had closed.
We offered to go in and close the windows a number of years ago, and they said we couldn't because of insurance purposes. And then they nailed them up after, like, locking the barn door after the horse is gone.
It was estimated that it would cost between $242,000 and $345,000 to board it up. Because of the financial commitment to the downtown mall, little was spent. Nothing was done about the leaky roof, which caused severe water damage. Later that year, the city removed the Casey's crown. Chunks had been falling off for years.
Well, I think the most distinctive thing architecturally was something that's not there anymore, which was that cornice, that big copper cornice, which is, you know, just those metal frames now.
Water now seeped even more into its steel skeleton. Not keeping the Casey dry rapidly ruined it.
When the city of Scranton took over the Casey, they should have secured the building better than they had, and not just let it dwindle and deteriorate like it has been. I think it was their responsibility to put a new roof on the place.
Governor Casey was the one who spurred action on the Hotel Casey site.
It wasn't until Governor Casey, on literally his last day in office, and he's a different family than the Casey Hotel family, but he put $10 million of free money in there that attracted developers.
In 1996, Century Hospitality, a developer from New York, was attracted to the project. They proposed to demolish the Casey and four adjacent properties to build a $31.6 million hotel and conference center. The company claimed to stand behind the project forever, which meant 16 months. Century lost its exclusive deal when it failed to obtain an $18.8 million mortgage.
They had a grander vision for the project, and so did we, and that's what attracted us to them. But then once they got into the project, the numbers just didn't work, and the project had to be scaled back instead of a $33 million project to about a $23 million project.
In 1998, the city picked First Hospitality of Chicago to court the hotel, but the state imposed sanctions for Scranton's failure to follow its financial recovery plan, withholding the $10 million. Even though the sanctions were eventually lifted, First Hospitality sat the dance out while Ellis Lane cut in. The Ellis Management Corporation of Westchester, Pennsylvania, and William H. Lane Incorporated of Binghamton, New York, comprised the partnership. On July 1, 1999, Governor Ridge, angry that this redevelopment project had the state's record for extensions, gave the Connors administration 15 conditions to meet by July 26th in order to receive the $10 million grant. As the countdown dwindled, 20-hour workdays became normal. The city met every condition except the most important one, obtaining financing. Governor Ridge blasted Connors in a letter, saying, "The primary cause for this project's failure to date is your own mismanagement and lack of leadership." The governor gave a final extension to show that private funds had been secured. In true City Hall fashion, there was a race for the deadline. 500 documents were delivered to Harrisburg on November 4th at 3:31 p.m., 89 minutes early. Governor Ridge released the grant, making the project a go. And it only took three developers, six deadlines, and over 4 years to start to bring the Scranton Hotel and Conference Center to fruition.
DPW went and brought the bricks. They were loaded on the truck. They were dropped off here last week. This is the second week that we've been giving the bricks out.
People are coming, and they want a piece of the project. It's got great memories for people. And then we have a plaque that we put together that people can stick on the brick, and a certificate of authenticity.
Across from the Casey is the site for the Scranton Hotel and Conference Center.
It'll bring about $6 million a year of new money into the area. So it'll be people coming from New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, kind of regional conferences.
I was even in touch with Mayor's office on a weekly basis trying to find out if this was going up, because the convention center itself would have lent itself to our seminar class sizes, and we hold a trade show, and it's going to be pretty cramped in the Radisson.
So is there any other venue in the area that could accommodate a convention?
None. Believe me, we looked.
I'd like to move on to what's going to go on there. Our intent there is to develop that land. As part of the contract that the city has with us is that both pieces of land were given. We have 5 years to develop both of them. We're developing this piece of land as a hotel and conference center, the Hilton Hotel. It's going to be a state of the art in communications. It's going to be a beauty.
The new $25 million hotel and conference center will be 165,000 square feet, seven stories, and will employ about 150 people. Opening is set for June 1, 2002. Part of the city's agreement with Ellis Lane includes demolishing the old hotel. Once the centerpiece of downtown, it became its biggest eyesore, always being the first thing you see when coming into Scranton.
Even today, when you come down the Central Scranton Expressway there, it's one of the first things you see, you know, now for better or for worse.
Most people come to our store because they are interested in model trains. And they're from out of the area, and the very first thing they see when they come into Scranton from the interstate was this empty building.
I'm thrilled that at least the KC will be down by the time I bring these people in, because it is such an eyesore.
Others sadly agree that the KC has to come down.
I'm not happy to see the hotel being demolished, but because of the condition that it is now in, I don't think there's anything but than to demolish the building.
I can't imagine that corner without it, you know what I mean? But to see the way it is now.
Well, in a way, you don't like to see it come down with all the memories that are there. But like I said, all they are now is memories. Half the people don't remember half what I told you today, you know? And so you have to make way for progress. You have to go with the progress.
Some wish that progress would have included more parts of the KC.
I would have liked to seen more of probably parts of the KC put into this plan than the previous plans.
I would take all this great expensive stonework that is too expensive to really replace today, and I'd reuse that on the first two floors of the new hotel. I'd do, you know, as much as I could to, in a dignified way, transfer the tradition and the history from this site over to that site.
But there is little history to transfer since the building was not properly secured.
Vandals have gotten in there over the years and has stripped out anything of value there, brass piping, copper piping. They were even as crazy enough to remove the asbestos off the pipes, throw it on the ground, and take the copper out.
19 years, almost two decades of abandonment. It was not properly secured against vandals or the elements. Tom Cipriano, KC artifact collector, went inside during the demolition process to save what the construction workers had not gotten to yet.
Why did I take them? I couldn't, I guess, justify letting these items just disappear into oblivion with the wrecking ball. So I was kind of like the crusader of history, if you will. Exhibits in the new hotel and conference center have been planned in the lobby. Hopefully some of the material will make it into their permanent collection. This piece in particular I chose to keep just to illustrate the deteriorating effects of the water. Just an example of the fine workmanship that went into the place and the ill fate that it has suffered.
If you look at the Casey's autopsy, the primary killers are water and government neglect. To see what these two factors can do to a building, a film crew went inside with KC historian Tom Rinaldi and became the KC's last guests.
Sum it up, I guess, for, you know, what the Hotel KC was like in its, you know, last years. was a dark, wet, very uninviting type place.
On the hotel's 50th anniversary, the Scranton Tribune reprinted an article written prior to the hotel's opening. It stated that the Pennsylvania Fireproofing Company conducted a test to show the strength of its construction. It was a test of the floor capacity. A space 4 feet square was marked off, and bags of cement were piled in the square while engineers watched carefully to note the deflection of the sag of the flooring. The newspaper account said the engineers would not have been surprised if a sag of 1/4 to 1/2 inch occurred. However, they were amazed when 7,282 pounds of cement were concentrated in a square, and a sag of only 1/16 of an inch was noted. One observer exclaimed, "It means the bottom will have to drop out of Mother Earth to move the casing." After 19 years of waiting on death row, hoping for a pardon, the Casey was delivered its sentence, death by wrecking ball.
It was our second home. You took it for granted. You just always thought it would be there and it would always be a part of your life.
Back in the 40s and 50s, nobody would ever believe that they would see the Hotel Casey coming down to the ground. Casey was the Casey, I mean, just king, just like I said.
My children even say to me, "Now, why didn't you hang on to it and everything?" But who would think at that time, you know, when you have young children and responsibilities and everything, you're not thinking that clearly ahead. I don't think we just had the foresight to think that some of us should have gotten together and kept it.
The Casey had finally tired of the dance. As each swing of a wrecking ball cuts into its walls, its bricks bleed and part of our tangible history is lost.
I hope they're gaining, but I know they've lost something. I don't think there'll ever be a place that influences people to come to Scranton like the Hotel Casey did.
There's so few architectural gems left, but something of that stature and meaning, so meaningful to so many people.
Why are they tearing it down? They're tearing it down because, you know, a series of events, you know, some of which could have been prevented, led to the demise of a great building.
All is not lost. The Casey Garage is going to be saved along with the Casey Laundry Building.
What we've decided now is, being that the Casey Laundry Building is in such good structural shape, the roof has been preserved, not like the Hotel Casey. We as a developer is going to be leaving the laundry building and bringing that back to life. We haven't decided if it's going to be storages or if it's going to be offices or what have you, but right now we're saying we're not taking it down. It's in good shape. It just needs a little tender love and care, and it's only because somebody kept the water out from the building.
Is that why the Hotel Casey deteriorated, the water?
One of probably the major reason. The roof leaked, never taken care of, and freeze thaw cycle as the water comes down. Buildings just aren't designed to take that.
The city shirked its responsibility by letting a prominent landmark in its downtown revitalization program fall into such disgusting decay.
This will really complete the downtown revitalization program.
It just went from bad to worse, and it seemed like nobody had a real interest in preserving it. I know the Architectural Heritage Society tried to block it, the Historical Society, because it's in the National Registry of Historical Landmarks.
It removes a million-dollar problem, because that building, the old Casey, was falling down.
I feel that there should have been efforts made to keep the building at least dry. Any broken windows should have been boarded up, you know, and there should have been a very minimal level of maintenance done to the building.
I don't know how they really got away with letting it deteriorate and strip it bare and tear it down. I still don't know how.
If the hotel had to close, that's one thing. It was a business. If it wasn't working out, that's fine. But there has to come a time when people you know, take a look at Lackawanna Avenue or any place in the city and realize that, okay, this is more than just a business. This is a landmark. This is a piece of our history.
Saving our architectural heritage cannot rest solely on City Hall. It rests on the community and our most powerful weapon, public opinion.
We, as a community or just as people, should do everything in our power to preserve history. But if it gets to the point where all we have are these, you know, glass buildings and stuff.
The Scranton Tribune commented that the Hotel Casey grew up with Scranton, or possibly the other way around. In just this one building was the best Scranton ever had to offer. To many thousands of travelers, the Casey was Scranton. The Irish brothers' foresight in building this extravagant hotel in 1911 helped reflect the unique transformation of Scranton from a watering hole to the greatest mining city in the world. But AJ and PJ were wrong. Scranton was not destined to be a metropolis, and the Casey mirrored the city's decline. Now, in an ironic twist of fate, Scranton's step toward progress will come at the non-existence of the Casey, once its most heralded trademark. Scranton is trying to turn itself into a tourism center based partly on its unique past, yet part of what illustrated this and made Scranton different is gone.
Did you ever look at yourself when you go on vacation? You like to go to a place that looks nice, has older buildings, well kept. We could have that right here in Scranton, Pennsylvania, if we instill on the owners of these buildings to keep the buildings up, keep them architecturally sound, keep them nicely painted, you know, freshly whitewashed or whatever, and this would be a destination place. To sum it up, when you go on vacation, just think of where you're leaving. And when you get to that destination, think of what those people did with their main streets, with their older buildings, with their older homes.
Others will counter that Samter's and the Globe Store have been saved, but that doesn't excuse the loss of the Casey. The revitalization of this landmark could have done so much for Scranton, like the Radisson did, because they don't build now like they did then. But we are blinded by the future, forgetting the past, destroying the past.
Lesson to be learned is that this doesn't need to happen, and you know, try and act before it becomes inevitable.
I think there is a lesson to be learned. The demise of the Casey hopefully will lead to the rebirth of another building.
You need to keep an eye out for other buildings like the Hotel Casey in Scranton and other cities.
I see the image of the Hotel Casey and the Hotel Sterling, windows left open.
Don't let it deteriorate.
Things like this don't need to happen.
If you own a property, keep the property up, so if you want to sell it, then sell it. Don't sell it as a dump.
With a little bit of public outcry, more can be done to try and preserve these buildings so that, you know, the example of the Hotel Casey can be realized.
Speak up, write articles, be involved in your community, and make sure that something like this doesn't happen again.
As the sun sets on the Hotel Casey, its rays refract in the neon tubes of the rooftop sign, giving one the impression that it's lit once again. The sign still proclaims to all in the valley the name of the Irish immigrants who gave Scranton its 11-story pot of gold. But then, the sun completes its descent and the glass tubes fall dark. In birth, the Casey was one of the greatest hotels in the country. In death, it has become one of the greatest ruins. Fittingly, its loss will be as great.
Yeah, I spent almost half of my life in there. The years went by so fast. I guess I would have been there now if the Casey had been there.